Welcome back to the next session of Design of Pre-Stressed Concrete Elements course. In the last session, we were discussing or we were calculating the deflection of pre-stressed concrete member. That is, we were working out the problems on deflection of pre-stressed concrete member. So in this connection, in today's session, let us work out a few more problems. So let me go ahead. So let me take the problem. So the problem says like this. A concrete beam with a rectangular section 100 mm wide and 300 mm deep is stressed by three cables. Oh, it is stressed by three cables, each carrying a effective force of 240 kN. The span of the beam is 10 meter. Okay, so let me go ahead with the number one, that is first cable. The first cable is parabolic with an eccentricity of 50 mm below the centroidal axis at the center of the span and 50 mm above the centroidal axis at the supports. So this is the details of the first cable. The second cable says like this. The second cable is parabolic with zero eccentricity at the support and an eccentricity of 50 mm at the center of the span or mid span. Okay, so this is regarding the second cable. Next, the third cable says like this. The third cable is straight with uniform eccentricity of 50 mm below the central axis. So these are the cable, they have been induced inside the rectangular section or in the rectangular pre-stressed concrete beam. So first one is parabola with an eccentricity of 50 mm below the centroidal axis at the center of the span and 50 mm above the centroidal axis at the support. The second cable is again the parabolic but zero eccentricity at the support and having an eccentricity of 50 mm at mid span or center of the span. Then the third cable is straight with a uniform eccentricity of 50 mm below the centroidal axis. Is it clear? So next, so in continuation with the problem, so next, if the beam supports a UD that is uniformly distributed live load of 5 kN per meter and modulus of elasticity of concrete 28 kN per millimeter square, so for this is asking estimate the instantaneous deflection at the following stages. So number one, pre-stress plus self-weight of the beam. Okay, number two, pre-stress plus self-weight plus live load. So these are the two stages. So as I stated, pre-stress plus self-weight means it is a transfer stage. Then pre-stress plus self-weight plus live load, it is a working stage, or I can say the service stage. Did you get my point? So in these particular stages, okay, they are asking what will be the instantaneous deflection. Okay, and one more thing, please remember, it is very, very, very important. Okay, in the last session, I didn't highlight this point, so I will highlight this point. Okay. So now whatever you people are calculated in the last session and in this particular session or in this particular problem, we are calculating the short-term deflection. So please note this point. It is very, very important. So I think as I have been discussed in the formula, so you can see in the formula. So as I have discussed, I have been written the formula. So this will be the short term. That means there will be two types of deflection, that is short-term deflection. So as I stated, short-term deflection at transfer is the deflection due to pre-stressing flows plus deflection due to the dead load. Again, if I want to calculate or if I want to add the short-term deflection at working stage, then the same deflection, that is deflection due to pre-stressing force plus deflection due to dead load plus deflection due to live load. Okay, so the both the formula will be okay, considered, or we are going to calculate the deflection. Okay, and both the deflection are short term deflection. Please note this, very, very, very important. Okay, so short term deflection will come into the picture in the case of a PSE beam, or else whatever the deflection till today, okay, we have assessed, that means in the last session and in this particular problem, are short term deflection. Please note this point. Okay, that is one thing. And another thing, whatever the deflection we are calculating, this is for uncracked structural pre-stressed concrete member. So I think I've been not been highlighted in the yesterday session or in the last session. So once again, I'm okay highlighting this very, very important points. One is, whatever you people calculated in the last session and in this problem, that is short term deflection you people are calculating at two different stages. One is short term deflection for transfer stage, that is deflection due to pre-stressing force and deflection due to the dead load. So this will come under transfer stage. Again, if I want to calculate the short term deflection at working stage, for this particular formula, the live load will add up. Did you get my point? So whenever you are going to calculate the deflection, okay, for any uncracked structural members, that is for PSC member, so those, okay, uncracked structural members, whatever I'm going to calculate the deflection, but by considering the loads and the pre-stressing force, so those deflection are called short term deflection. So please, please remember these points, because today I'm going to teach you, okay, also the long term deflection. So that's why I'm specifying, okay, I'm making you the clear point. Okay, so whatever you people are going to do, okay, now that is short term deflection for uncracked structural PSC member. And mainly I'm going to teach you, okay, uncracked structural PSC members only. That means I'm going to calculate the short term deflection and also the long term deflection for uncracked structural PSC member. That means at the initial stage or during the uncracked stage, okay, what will be the deflection both in the short term and in the long term? So that I'm going to calculate. Is it clear? So these two points is very, very important. You need to know, because in the problem they are going to ask these things. Okay, so now let us continue with that problem. So let me go ahead with that problem. So now this is the problem they have been given. It is a rectangular section, 100 mm wide and 300 mm deep, stressed by three cables which have been mentioned. The span of the beam is 10 meter and each cable will be stressed with an effective force of 240 kilonewton. Okay, next, if the beam supports a uniformly distributed live load of 5 kilonewton per meter and EC, that is modulus of elasticity of concrete, what will be the instantaneous deflection at these stages? Okay, that means you are assessing the short-term deflection for a rectangular PSC beam or member. So let us go ahead. So this will be the longitudinal section of a PSC beam. Okay, so as I stated, the cable number one, which is marked in red color, okay, that is, it will be having a mid-span eccentricity of 50 mm and the end, that is support eccentricity of 50 mm. Okay, this is the first cable. So coming to the second cable, which have been marked in blue color. So once again, the second cable is also a parabolic cable, but the eccentricity will be different. That is, the mid-span is having a 50 mm eccentricity, and at the support it is zero. Next, coming to the third cable, that is straight cable, okay, it will be having a constant eccentricity of 50 mm throughout the span. So this is regarding the details of the cables that has been induced inside the pre-stressed concrete beam. And this will be the cross section. Okay, as I stated, it's a rectangular beam of dimension 100 mm wide and 300 mm deep. So let us proceed. Okay, so as I stated, so please Okay, first initially calculate all the parameters. So that is P. Okay, that is the what the pre-stressing force induced in each cable is equal to 240 kilonewton. Span 10 meter, that is 10,000 millimeter. Next, live load. Okay, the live load that is acting on the beam is 5 kilonewton per meter. So this will be the live load that will be acting on the beam. So which is of 5 kilonewton. And very important, it is uniformly distributed live load. Is it clear? Next, modulus of elasticity of concrete, 28 kilonewton per millimeter square. Okay, then let me go ahead with the moment of inertia, that is BD cubed by 12. 100 into 300 cubed by 12, that is 225 10 to the power of 6 millimeter to the power of 4. Next, dead load, that is cross-sectional area multiplied by the density of concrete, that is 0.1 into 0.3, which is equal to 0.72 kilonewton per meter. So you see in the problem, density of concrete has not been given. So let us assume the density 24 kilonewton per meter cube. So the answer will be, okay, 0.72 kilonewton per meter. Okay, 0.72 kilonewton per meter. Okay, so if I want to express in other units, that will be 0.72 newton per millimeter or 0.00072 kilonewton per millimeter. Is it clear? So these are all the data. Okay, I need to, okay, know. Next. So let me go with the first one, deflection due to pre-stressing force. So if I want to calculate the instantaneous deflection for transfer stage, so let me go ahead with first deflection due to the pre-stressing force. So now, if I want to calculate the deflection due to pre-stressing force, three cables are there. So the three types of cables are there. So let us calculate the deflection for each cable. Okay, so coming to the first one, that is deflection due to the first cable. So since it is a parabolic, which is having a eccentric anchors. So hence the formula, we know that PL square by 48 EI into minus 5 E1 plus E2. So this will be the formula. So let us substitute carefully. 240 kilonewton into 10,000 square divided by 48 into 28 kilonewton per millimeter square. So please be careful because I have been substituted P in kilonewton. Once again, okay, I'm going to substitute the E also in kilonewton per millimeter square into I, okay, multiply by minus 5 into E1 is 50, that is midspan eccentricity, plus E2 support eccentricity 50, which is 15.87 millimeter upwards. So as we know that the deflection due to pre-stressing force will create upward, okay, deflection. So hence the convention will be upwards, or the arrow mark will be upwards. Next, deflection due to the second cable. Once again, as we know that second cable is also parabolic, but with, okay, you know that the midspan eccentricity is 50 mm, but the support eccentricity is zero. So for this, the formula will be minus 5 into PEL square by 48 EI. So let me substitute that. That is 5 into P is 240 kilonewton into eccentricity 50 into L 10,000 square divided by 48 into 28 kilonewton per millimeter square into 225 to the power of 6. So once if you substitute everything, okay, the answer will be 19.84 millimeter. Okay, so this will be the deflection, upward deflection. Next, deflection due to the third cable, which is a straight cable, the formula is PE into L square divided by 8EI. So for this, let me substitute 240 into 50 into 10,000 square divided by 8 into 28 kilonewton per millimeter square into moment of inertia. So the answer will be 23.80. And please observe here, okay, very important thing. So comparing all the cables, the upper deflection is more in the case of straight cable as compared to the parabolic cable. Is it clear? Next, coming to the next, deflection due to dead load, because we have been calculated the deflection due to the pre-stressing force. Since if you want to calculate the instantaneous deflection at transfer stage and working stage, the next parameter required will be deflection due to dead load. So that is deflection due to dead load is equal to. So as I stated, the dead load will be acting as a UDL. So hence the formula will be, okay, phi WDL into L to the power of 4 divided by 384 EI. So this will be the formula. Let us substitute phi into 0.0072 kilonewton per millimeter. So please note down 0.0072 kilonewton per millimeter into 10,000 to the power of 4 divided by 384 into, so since I have substituted the WDL in kilonewton per millimeter, I will substitute EC also in kilonewton per millimeter square, that is 28 into 225 to the power of 6. The answer will be 14.88 millimeter. So please, there is a small mistake here. So it is not upward arrow, it is downward arrow. So we know that, okay, the deflection due to the dead load and live load will create downward deflection, not upward. Okay, only pre-stress will produce the upward deflection. Is it clear? So please note this point. Next, let me go ahead. So deflection due to live load. Okay, because we also need to calculate the instantaneous deflection at working stage. Hence, I'm going to calculate the deflection due to live load. So now once, if you want to calculate the deflection due to live load, you need to observe the problem clearly. That is, what will be the live load acting on the beam? So in this particular problem, so the live load will be acting as a UDL. So hence the formula will be phi WL into L to the power of 4 divided by 384 EI. That is phi into, okay, that live load will be 0.005, okay, 0.005 into 10,000 to the power of 4 divided by 384 into 28, okay, into 225 into the power of 6. So the answer will be 103.3. So once, okay, it will be subjected to the live load, you can see the deflection has rise to, okay, this much. That is 103.33 millimeter. Is it clear? So these are the deflection have been calculated. Now let us go with the conditions. So now instantaneous deflection due to the pre-stress plus self-weight equal to, okay, instantaneous deflection due to pre-stress plus self-weight is equal to minus, okay, you can see, you can sum up all these things. Okay, that is minus 15.87, minus 19.84, minus 23.80, plus 14.88. Please note this point. I will repeat. So instantaneous deflection due to pre-stressing force plus self-weight equal to minus 15.87, minus 19.84, minus 23.80. Why minus? Because upward in deflection, okay, the sign convention will be negative. Okay, then plus 14.88, because the deflection due to dead load will be downward, which indicates positive. The answer, the final answer will be 44.63 millimeter, which is acting upwards. Okay, that means whatever the final answer you are going to obtain will be minus 44.63 millimeter. So the upward deflection will be predominant, or the net deflection will be upward only. Hence, okay, 44.63 millimeter, okay, which I'm going to notate with upward arrow mark. Next, instantaneous deflection due to pre-stress plus self-weight plus live load. So once again, same, okay. Now, minus 15.87, minus 19.84, minus 23.80, plus 14.88, plus 103.3. Okay, here, okay, you can see, you will get a positive, that is 43.82 millimeter, which is acting downward, because you can see the deflection due to live load will be, okay, predominant. The net effect, or the net deflection due to pre-stress plus self-weight plus live load, okay, here the downward deflection is predominant, hence we are going to get the this notation. Is it clear? So like this, we need to solve the problem, okay, in the examination if you are going to come across this type of problem. Is it clear? So hope you have understood this problem. Okay, so let me proceed with the next problem. So let me go ahead with the next problem. So now the next problem says like this. A PEC beam of rectangular section 120 mm wide and 300 mm deep. Okay, 120 mm wide and 300 mm deep. Spans over 6 meter. The beam is pre-stressed by straight cable, please note down, carrying an effective force of 180 kN at an eccentricity of 50 millimeter. If it supports a imposed load of 4 kN per meter, imposed load means live load of 4 kN per meter, and modulus of elasticity of concrete 38 kN per millimeter square. Okay, for this, compute the deflection at the following stages and check whether they comply with the IS code specifications or not. Did you get my point? So the first condition is calculate the deflection. It is clearly they have been mentioned. Okay, upward deflection under pre-stress plus sulfate. So we know that from the previous problem. So during transfer stage, okay, whatever the cable have been induced, which will be predominant to, okay, can say that in the net deflection, hence, okay, we are going to get the upward deflection, okay, pattern. So hence they have been clearly mentioned upward. So once the same beam, if I'm going to subject with a live load, okay, there the downward deflection will be predominant, that is the downward arrow. So hence they have been asked final downward deflection. Okay. So apart from this, so please observe one important thing they have been highlighted here. Okay, that is including the effect of creep and shrinkage, assuming a creep coefficient to be 1.8. So now, till now, okay, whatever the problem we have been solved, as I've highlighted, okay, so those conditions have been calculated is short-term deflection, okay, have been calculated. Now, in this particular problem, is asking calculate the downward deflection by considering the loads. Apart from this, consider or include effects of creep and shrinkage. So when the creep and shrinkage parameter will come in the case of deflection, then whatever the deflection you are going to calculate will be long-term deflection. Please note this point. I think I have been highlighted these conditions while discussing, okay, that is the limits of deflection as per IS 1343. Okay, so there will be two types of deflection you are going to come across in the uncracked structural PSC member. So whatever the problem I'm solving, okay, and whatever the formulas I'm using, it is for uncracked structural PSC member. Please note this point. It is an uncracked structural PSC member. For this uncracked structural PSC member, okay, till now I have been calculated the short-term deflection by subjecting or by considering only the loads. But in this particular problem, apart from the loads, is also asking the final downward deflection by considering loads and also the effect of creep and shrinkage. So when the creep and shrinkage parameter will come, so those deflection will be called as long-term deflection, because the creep effect will be there for number of years. Okay, hence, okay, let us go ahead with this, how to calculate short-term and long-term deflection for this particular rectangular section PSC beam. So let us go ahead. So now let me write down. So this will be the PSC beam. Okay, so this will be the PSC beam, and this will be the centroidal axis. Okay, and the span, it states the span of the beam is 6 meter. So let me notate that it is 6 meter. Okay. Next, it will be having a constant eccentricity, because they have been clearly mentioned it is a straight cable. the beam is prestressed by a straight cable. So obviously straight cable means it is having a constant eccentricity, which will be 50 millimeter. So this will be 50 millimeter and it will be pre-stressed, okay, at the either ends with a pre-stressing force of 180 kilonewton. Okay, next. So the cross section of this beam is 120 by 300. The cross section of the beam is 120. Okay, multiply. Okay, this is 120 and the overall depth is 300. So this will be 300. Okay, so this will be the cross section and this is the longitudinal section. So let me go ahead. So as I stated, let me write down all the parameters or basic data. So pre-stressing force 180 kilonewton, E 50 millimeter. So moment of inertia for a rectangular section, that is 120 into 300 cube by 12, B into D cube by 12, which is 27 into 10 to the power of 7 millimeter to the power of 4. Then modulus of elasticity of concrete, 38 kilonewton per millimeter square. Then coming to the dead load, WDL equal to 0.12 into 0.3 into density of concrete, 24 kilonewton per meter cube, which is 0.86 kilonewton per meter or 0.86 newton per millimeter or 0.0086 kilonewton per millimeter. So these are all the things. Next, the live load. Okay, so you need to be very careful while writing the live load. So as I stated, so here also the live load is acting as UDL. Okay, so that is 4 kilonewton per meter. Okay, next are 0.004, okay, kilonewton per, okay, millimeter. Then the span is 6000 millimeter. So as I stated, if I want to calculate the deflections, okay, so let me go ahead. So now the whatever the upper deflection you will going to calculate will be considered as short-term deflection. The short-term deflection for or during transfer stage. So that, let me go ahead with first deflection due to pre-stressing force equal to, okay, what will be the formula for a straight cable? Okay, that will be PE L square divided by 8EI. Is it clear? So let me substitute. P is 180 kilonewton into eccentricity 50, length is 6000 square divided by 8 into 38 kilonewton per millimeter square into moment of inertia 27 into 10 to the power of 7. The answer will be 4 millimeter, okay, which will be upper deflection, that is upward arrow mark. Next, deflection due to self-weight, so it will be UDL. So hence 5WD into L to the power of 4 divided by 384 EI, which is 5 into 0.00386 into 0.0086 into 6000 to the power of 4 divided by 384 into 38 kilonewton per millimeter square, because I have substituted the WDL in kilonewton per millimeter. So hence I'm also going to substitute is in kilonewton per millimeter square. And this will be the I. The answer will be 1.4 millimeter, which is acting downwards. Did you get my point? Okay. Next, deflection due to, okay, self-weight. Okay, and the imposed load, so which is very much required. I will tell you, okay, why are being considered together. So deflection due to self-weight and imposed load is equal to, since both self-weight and imposed load are UDL, so hence I'm going to consider them together. So that is 5, okay, multiply by 0.86 plus 4, that is 4.86 into 6000 to the power of 4. So since I've been substituted the answer in newton per millimeter, so let me go at 384 into 38 into the power of 3 newton per millimeter square into I. So the answer will be 8 mm, which is acting downwards. Okay, so why I've been considered that together, I will explain now. So now let me go ahead with the first condition, that is upper deflection under pre-stress plus self-weight. So for this, pre-stress plus self-weight, which is equal to minus 4, which is this thing, plus 1.4, which is equal to 2.66 mm acting upwards, because during transfer stage, the upper deflection will be predominant. Okay, so as it stated, check the, so it is clearly saying, okay, check whether they comply with IS code or not, or whether it's within the permissible. So whatever the short-term deflection I've been, so this is called short-term, please notice. Okay, whatever I've been calculated, that is A, the condition A, which is called short-term deflection. So please note this point, this is called short-term deflection. So short-term deflection for transfer stage, -4 plus 1.4, that is 2.6 millimeter. So now whatever the 2.6 millimeter, okay, we have been calculated for, that is the short-term deflection, we have been calculated for rectangular member. So whether which is lies within the permissible limit or not. So that permissible deflection as per IS 1343 2012, so span by 300. Okay, that means without considering the effect of creep and shrinkage. So for that span by 300, which is equal to 6000 by 300, that is 20 millimeter. So now whatever that upper deflection which is there, so which is less than the 20 mm, hence the upper deflection or this, okay, the deflection or short-term deflection at transfer stage will be within the permissible limit. So now let me go ahead with next case, that is final downward deflection. So now clearly is mentioned, apart from this, that is deflection due to the loads, it is also okay, or you need to consider also the effect of creep and shrinkage. For this, what I'm going to write down, that is long-term deflection. Please note this point, this is called long-term deflection. Okay, so this is long-term deflection. So the long-term deflection will be come into the picture when the effect of creep and shrinkage will, okay, consider. So for this, the formula will be, that is the long-term deflection due to this, okay, these loads and effect of creep and shrinkage will be deflection due to the pre-stressing force, deflection due to the pre-stressing force plus deflection due to the, what I can say, the dead load and live load, that is considering together WD and WL. So that's why I've been considered. Otherwise, you can calculate separately and you can add. Okay, instead of that, okay, because in this particular stage, I need to consider self weight and live load both. So hence I've been calculated. But in the examination, if they give the live load as concentrated load, then you cannot use this formula. You need to calculate separately. That is self weight, you already been calculated. Okay, that is separately. And live load, you need to calculate, okay, by using a proper formula, that is deflection, okay, due to live load. Okay, for concentrated load, that formula we need to use and then sum up and substitute here. So you need to be very careful. Okay, so this is within the bracket, multiply by 1 plus creep coefficient, so that they have been considered. I will repeat, long-term deflection is equal to deflection due to pre-stressing force plus deflection due to the dead load and live load. So all these are load. Multiply by 1 plus creep coefficient. Okay, so let me substitute. So you already know the deflection due to pre-stressing force is -4 plus deflection due to dead load and live load will be 8, multiply by 1 plus creep coefficient, they have been given in the problem, which is 1.8. So after substituting everything, you will get 11.2 millimeter, which is acting downwards. Is it clear? Okay, so like this, we need to calculate the long-term deflection by using this formula. So now whatever the deflection you have been calculated, now let me check whether which is within the permissible limit or not. So now permissible downward deflection as per IS 1343 2012, considering everything, that is effect of creep, shrinkage, loads, that means finishes, everything, the formula will be span by 250. Please note this, this is very important. This formula will be without considering the effect of creep and shrinkage. And this formula will be with considering effect of creep and shrinkage. So that is 6000 divided by 250, which is 24 millimeter. So now please check whatever the long-term deflection or final downward deflection we have been calculated. So this deflection is within the permissible limit. So hence the rectangular PSE beam or the uncracked PSE beam, okay, will be safe both in long term and short term deflection. So like this we need to calculate. Okay, so hope you have understood the problem. Okay, how to go ahead, because in yesterday's session whatever I have been calculated by considering the effect of pre-stressing force and load, hence it is a short term deflection. So if I consider the effect of creep and shrinkage, so those will be called as long term deflection. Is it clear? So this is regarding the problem. Okay, so you can expect this type of problem also in the examination. Okay, so let me move on further. One sec. Yeah. Okay, so next problem is like this. Okay, so this is also one of the typical problem I've been taken. So please listen carefully. A pre-stressed concrete beam 200 by 500 is pre-stressed by parabolic cable having an eccentricity of 50 mm above the neutral axis at the ends of the beam, that is at the support, and 150 mm at the midspan. Okay, so 50 mm at the support and 150 mm at the midspan. It carries a uniformly distributed loads of 10 kN per meter in addition to two concentrated load of 10 kN acting at, okay, so that is, it carries a UDL of 10 kN per meter in addition to two concentrated loads of 10 kN acting at one fourth of a span. So please note this, it is acting at one fourth of a span. Okay, points. Next, the pre-stressing force induced in the cable is 250 kN. Consider creep coefficient 2. Next, loss in pre-stress is 20%. That means loss has been encountered in the case of PSE beam. So for this, estimate the short-term and long-term deflection. Estimate the short-term and long-term deflection. Apart from this, whatever the deflection you have been calculated or estimated, so for that, check the adequacy of the beam from deflection criteria. Okay, and please note down, consider the grade of concrete M35. Okay, so these are the data they have been given. So now please listen here. So what is the change from the last problem and this problem? So now one thing, the aim of the problem in the last and in this problem both are same, that is calculating short term and long term deflection. Fine. Okay, and they have been given a creep coefficient, everything. Okay, fine. Okay, but two things there will be change in the problem. One is, in the last case, okay, the beam was subjected only with the UDL. But in this particular problem, apart from UDL, okay, two additional concentrated loads are acting at one fourth span. Okay, that is the one change. Okay, and another change, a very important change, is in this particular problem, loss has been encountered. So you need to consider those loss and calculate the deflection. So that he has been highlighted. Did you get my point? So by considering the losses in pre-stress, that is of 20%, you need to calculate the deflection. So that is the change from last problem. Okay, so that is the change in the last problem. So let me go ahead. So let me draw the longitudinal section. So I've been drawn 10 meter. So I've been put a parabolic cable 150 mm at midspan and end eccentricity 50 mm at the supports, subjected to UDL of 10 kN per meter, two additional concentrated load at one fourth of a span, that is 10 divided by 4, that is 2.5. So these two concentrated loads are acting at one fourth point, that is 2.5 meter from the supports. Next, this will be the cross section, that is 200 multiplied by 500. Okay. And it is pre-stressed by a pre-stressing force of 250 kN. So these things have been drawn. Let me go ahead with calculating the data or initial parameters. So that is first thing is cross-sectional area, that is 0.2 into 0.5. Okay, fine. Next, moment of inertia, that is BD cube by 12, that is 200 into 500 cube by 12, which is equal to 2.08 into 10 to the power of 9 millimeter to the power of 4. Next, pre-stressing force, which is 250 kilonewton. Next, coming to the dead load, that is cross-sectional area of a section multiplied by the density of concrete, that is 2.4 kilonewton per meter or 2.4 newton per millimeter or 0.0024 kilonewton per millimeter. So these are the things. Next, a very interesting you need to note here is till now I used to give the modulus of elasticity of concrete in all the problem. But in this particular problem, instead of giving modulus of elasticity of concrete, they have been given the grade of concrete. Is it clear? So now, how to calculate the modulus of elasticity of concrete with respect to the grade of a concrete? So we know from the IS-1343 or from IS-456, the theoretical modulus of elasticity we can calculate using the formula 5700 root FCK. I will repeat, 5700 root FCK. So that is 5700 root of 35, which is a grade of concrete, which will be 33.72, almost have been equated to 35 kilonewton per millimeter square. In the examination, you can do with 34 also, or you can do with 33.72 also, no change. But I've been rounded off to the nearest whole number, so that is 35 kilonewton per millimeter square. Is it clear? So now let me go ahead with the first one. So let me go ahead with the first case, that is calculation of short-term deflection for rectangular PSC member. So that is short-term deflection. Let me go ahead. So deflection due to self-weight, which is equal to, so as I stated, the self-weight will be acting as a UDL. So that is 5WDL into L to the power of 4 divided by 384 into EI. So that is 5 into, I've been substituted the, okay, the WDL in kilo, okay, newton per millimeter, that is 2.4 into newton per millimeter, multiply by the length 10,000 to the power of 4 divided by 384 into the modulus of elasticity of concrete, 35 into the power of 3 newton per millimeter square into 2.08 into the power of 9. The answer you are going to obtain is 4.29 millimeter. Okay, so this will be downward. So that is deflection due to self weight, because these are the, okay, the self weight or the load acting on the beam. Next, deflection due to the live load, which is UDL, because please observe, okay, the beam is subjected to the two types of loading. One is UDL, another one is concentrated load. So let me first calculate the deflection due to the live load UDL. That is, okay, so as the live load is UDL, the formula is 5 into WL into L to the power of 4 divided by 384 into EI. That is 5 into, okay, the dead load is, that is 10 kilonewton per meter or newton per millimeter into 10,000 to the power of 4 divided by 384 into 35 into 10 to the power of 3, okay, newton per millimeter square into 2.08 into the power of 9. So which is 17.90 millimeter, which is acting downwards. Am I right? Okay. So next, deflection due to concentrated loads. Okay. And please observe these concentrated loads, okay, will be acting at, okay, different, okay, span. Okay. This will be acting at 1/4 span. Okay, not at mid span or not at 1/3 span. It is acting at 1/4 of a span. So for this, let me go ahead with the formula. The formula for this type is a new formula, that is beta, which is a multiplication factor, okay, into moment due to those concentrated load into span, total span square divided modulus of elasticity of concrete into moment of inertia. So where beta is equal to 1 by 24 into 3 minus 4 into the end support distance, that is A, divided by L overall span square. Okay, so this is the formula, okay, or multiplication factor you are going to consider for the concentrated loads. Okay, that is the two concentrated load, that is 1/4 span. So let me substitute 1 divided by 24 into 3 minus 4, multiply by A, that is supporting distance, okay, that is 2.5 meter, so 2.5 divided by the overall span 10 meter square. So the answer will be 0.1146. So this is the factor, okay, you need to consider. So let me substitute, okay. Next, what about M? How to calculate M? So that is the moment of a concentrated load, okay. Okay, that is 10 into, so you see here, so the moment of a concentrated load, I'm going to consider the moment at this support. So that is 10 into 2.5. Okay, so that is 10 into 2.5, which is 25 kilonewton meter. So let me substitute that. Okay, 0.1146 into 25 10 to the power of 6. Why? Because I've been substituted the answer in newton millimeter. I've been substituted the answer in newton millimeter. Multiply by the span square divided by 35 into 10 to the power of 3 into 2.08 into the power of 9. Okay, so see here, so these things are very important. Since I've been substituted the moment in newton millimeter, I need to substitute E also in newton per millimeter square. So the answer will be 3.94 millimeter, which is acting on, because all these deflections are downward deflection. So next, deflection due to the pre-stress, that is PL square by Y. Why I've used this formula? Because it is the parabolic, that is, okay, I can say the varying eccentricity or eccentric anchors. It is eccentric anchors. So for this particular case, the formula will be PL square by 48 EI multiplied by minus 5 E1 plus E2. That is 250 kilonewton multiplied by 10,000 square divided by 48 into 35 kilonewton per millimeter square into 2.08 into the power of 9 multiply by minus 5 into E1 means mid-span eccentricity, which is how much? The mid-span eccentricity is 150. So let me substitute. So in the examination, you need to be very careful. If you substitute, okay, 5 into 50 plus 150 in a hurry, okay, you will going to lose this, okay, marks. That means the problem will become wrong from this instance. So hence, so we need to be very careful while substituting each parameter. Okay, so minus 5 into mid-span eccentricity plus support eccentricity. So the answer will be 5 millimeter, which will be acting upwards. So now, as it stated, short-term deflection by considering. So as I stated, the short-term deflection will be coming into the picture only when live load, dead load, and pre-stressing force will be considered. Did you get my point? So for that, deflection due to sulfate is 4.29 plus deflection due to live load, because two consideration will be coming. One is due to UDL and another one is two concentrated loads. So 17.90 plus 3.94 minus 5, because upper deflection, that is minus 5. So the answer will be 21.13 millimeter, which is acting downwards. So let me check whether this will be within the permissible limit or not. Okay. At a later stage. Next, long-term deflection, okay, which is, as I stated, that is deflection due to the loads, okay, minus deflection due to the pre-stress. Am I right? So in the previous case also, the same thing I've been considered, deflection due to the loads positive and deflection due to the pre-stress, which will be negative. But so this deflection I need to multiply with the, okay, the loss ratio. That means this particular pre-stress, okay, whatever the pre-stress or pre-stressing force that has been induced, okay, by taking into consideration of loss ratio, that means the loss has been occurred, okay, multiply by 1 plus creep coefficient. In the previous case, okay, no loss of pre-stress was given in the problem, but in this particular problem, the loss ratio is given. So this loss ratio you need to multiply to the deflection due to pre-stress. Did you get my point? So now 4.29, that is deflection due to self weight plus deflection due to live load minus deflection due to pre-stress, that is 5, into loss ratio, that is 80%. The ratio is 80 by 100, which is 0.8. Multiply by 1 plus creep coefficient, which is creep coefficient, they have been given 2. So hence, substituting everything, you will get 66.4 millimeter. So this will be the answer. So now let me check whether these deflections are within the permissible limit or not. So now, adequacy of the section. So now, allowable deflection. Okay, let me go ahead. So as I stated, without considering the effect of creep and shrinkage, it will be span by 300. Considering creep and shrinkage, it will be span by 250. So now I'm checking for long-term deflection. So as per IS 1343-2012, allowable or permissible deflection is equal to span by 250. So this formula holds good by considering the effect of creep and shrinkage. So that is 10,000 divided by 250, which is 40 millimeter. So please observe now. So whatever the long-term deflection you have been calculated, which is 66.4 millimeter, but the permissible deflection is how much? 40 mm. So for this, as the long-term deflection is greater than the allowable deflection, the beam is unsafe from deflection criteria. The beam is unsafe. That means if I considering the effect of creep and shrinkage, the deflection, okay, is going to happen enormously. So by now taking care of this creep and shrinkage, okay, you need to go ahead with the deflection. So at that particular instance, I can, okay, take care of this, okay, or the whatever the deflection have been calculated, which will be the permissible limit. So now, if I want to know the, okay, the limits of short-term deflection, that is, as we know, the span is how much? The span is, I can say the 10,000. Okay, yes, it is 10,000. Okay. 10,000, okay, divided by 300, okay, so that is 33.33 millimeter, okay, whatever the short-term deflection I have been calculated, so is within the permissible limit, so hence, okay, for deflection due to the live load, deflection due to the pre-stress, and deflection due to self-weight, which is safe, but when the creep and shrinkage effect is considered, the beam will undergo, okay, deflection, which is not safe or which is unsafe. Did you get my point? So like this, we need to go ahead with the numerical problems in deflection. Is it clear? So any doubts? Any doubts? Okay, so in this, okay, please note down. Okay, I can see. So I've been worked out varieties of problems in the deflection. So please work out the problem. Okay, today I've been worked out long-term deflection case also. So in yesterday's session, whatever I've been discussed, that is short-term deflection. So in this particular session, apart from short-term deflection, I've also been discussed long-term deflection. Is it clear? So let me conclude this deflection part. So when I'm going to calculate the deflection, there will be two types of deflection. One, it is short-term deflection, another one is long-term deflection. So depending upon the situation, okay, I need to calculate. The short-term deflection will be coming into the picture only in the case of transfer stage and working stage. That is pre-stress plus self-weight and pre-stress plus self-weight plus live load. Okay, at this particular instant, the short-term deflection will come. And in the long-term deflection, the shrinkage and creep criteria will come. So at that particular instant, long-term deflection will come. And the next thing you need to be very important while calculating the deflection due to pre-stressing force. So depending upon the type of the cable profile, you need to use the proper formula. Next, deflection due to self-weight, no doubt. Okay, it is always be UDL. But deflection due to live load, which you are going to calculate, you need to be very cautious because depending upon the live load, you need to go ahead with the formula. For example, central concentrated load, it will be different. Okay, 2-point load, it will be different. UDL, it will be different. Okay, so based upon those formula, you need to go ahead with the deflection due to live load. Okay, so like this, we need to calculate the deflection for the PSC members. So as I've highlighted, so this is the way we are going to calculate the deflection for uncracked PSC members. So initially, I've been told, so whatever you people are going to calculate, all these things for uncracked PSC member. So that's why, okay, all these things, you know that the uncracked PSC members, how they are going to calculate. So that is area of BMD. So I think you from the basics, you know that area of bending moment diagram divided by flexural rigidity, that is EI. So now, after considering the Mohr's theorem, that is for the further effect, that is considering the Mohr's theorem, so these formula will arrive. Okay, so these aspects you know from the basic strength of materials class, so which are not been highlighted here much. Okay, directly I've been started, but now I've been highlighting these things. So all these formula is for uncracked structural PSC members. Is it clear? So with these, I'm going to end the deflection part. Okay, and also by this, we have completed the module number 2 almost. Okay, so hope you have understood the concept clearly, whatever I've been discussed in module number 2. So both in loss of pre-stress and also deflection part. Okay, so with this, I'm going to end the session. Thank you.